Yang berhormat Datuk Seri Idris Jusoh, Menteri Pendidikan II, Kementerian Pendidikan Malaysia. Yang berbahagia Datuk Seri Syed Zainal Abidin Syed Muhammad Tahir, Managing Director WIDU Sdn Berhad. Yang berbahagia Tan Sri Datuk Seri Utama Dr. Ashad Ayub, Pro Chancellor Universiti Teknologi MARA. Yang berbahagia Tan Sri Datuk Seri Insinyur Profesor Dr. Sahul Hamid Abu Bakar, Naib Chancellor Universiti Teknologi MARA, ahli-ahli lembaga pengarah UiTM, wakil-wakil dari Kementerian Pendidikan Malaysia, timbalan-timbalan Naib Chancellor UiTM dan IPT Malaysia, barisan pengurusan kanan UiTM, hadirin hadirat serta para mahasiswa dan mahasiswi Universiti Teknologi MARA. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera dan salam satu Malaysia, juga salam satu UiTM. Majlis pada petang ini dimulakan dengan pembacaan doa oleh Yang Berusaha Al-Ustaz Tuan Haji Lufti Fauzi Sabari daripada Academy of Contemporary Islamic Studies Universiti Teknologi MARA. Dengan segala hormatnya dipersilakan Al-Ustaz.
Al-Fatihah. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمدك ربنا ونستعين به ونستفتح بالذي هو الخير والصلاة والسلام على النبي المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم يبعثون اللهم إنا نسألك خير هذا اليوم وخير هذا الأسبوع وخير هذا الشهر وخير هذا العام فتحه ونصره وبركته وهدى ونعوذ بك من شره وشر ما فيه وشر ما قبله وشر ما بعده اللهم يا الله. Kami berhimpun di dewan yang mulia ini bagi menyatakan kesyukuran kami kepadamu yang telah mempertemukan kami dalam program CEO Industri dan IPT pada petang ini. Oleh itu engkau jadikan hari ini lebih baik bagi kami dari hari yang telah lalu. Akidah kami semakin kukuh, ibadah kami semakin bertambah, akhlak kami semakin cemerlang, rezeki kami semakin luas dan halal, umur kami umur yang diberkati, dan amal kami amal yang diridhai. Allahumma ya zal fadli wal an'ami ya zal jalali wal ikram. Pada petang yang mulia ini, kami mendatangkan memohon doa restu darimu ya Allah. Engkau berkatilah majlis ini. Engkau jadikan segala usaha dan amal kami ini sebagai amal yang engkau redai. Anugerahkanlah kepada kami hidayah dan taufik agar segala urusan kami pada hari ini berjalan dengan lancar, beroleh kejayaan dan keberkatan. Tanamkanlah di dalam hati-hati kami sifat-sifat ikhlas dan jujur dalam menyempurnakan tanggungjawab kami. Bukakanlah pintu hati kami untuk menjadi manusia yang sempurna, manusia yang berjiwa waja, sentiasa sanggup menghadapi rintangan dan cabaran demi agama, bangsa dan negara yang tercinta ini. Allahumma ya basita ya hafizu ya raqib. Ya Allah ya Tuhan kami, lindungilah negara kami yang tercinta ini dari segala ancaman dan mara bahaya, agar kami dapat hidup dalam aman merdeka. Hindarilah kami dari bala bencana seperti gempa bumi, banjir besar dan wabak penyakit. Jauhilah kami dari segala kemungkaran, perpecahan, pertelingkahan yang tiada berkesudahan dan merugikan. Kami pohonkan jua ya Allah keselamatan dan kesejahteraan kepada universiti kami yang tercinta ini agar terus terpelihara dan terus maju di bawah naungan-Mu ya Allah. Allahumma ja'al jam'ana hadza jam'an marhuma wa tafarruqana min ba'dihi tafarruqan ma'suma wa la taj'al fina wa la ma'ana syaqiyyan wa la matrudan wa la mahruma. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina azaban nar. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Taqabbalallahu minkum.
Majlis merakamkan ribuan terima kasih kepada Yang Berusaha Tuan Haji Lufti Fauzi Sabari di atas pembacaan doa sebentar tadi. Tetamu-tetamu kehormat, hadirin hadirat yang dimuliakan, Program pada petang ini yang pada awalnya diberi nama CEO Faculty Program oleh pihak kementerian dengan objektif utamanya untuk memperhebatkan pernyataan daripada sektor industri sebagai sebahagian daripada sistem pendidikan tinggi negara melalui pengkongsian pengalaman dan kepakaran tokoh-tokoh dari industri. Pada petang ini, Pejabat Jaringan Industri Masyarakat dan Alumni, ICAN dengan kerjasama bahagian komunikasi korporat, hal ehwal pelajar dan juga hal ehwal akademik telah diberi mandat oleh pihak universiti untuk menganjurkan program yang bercirikan pengkongsian pengalaman seorang CEO dengan harapan ia boleh dijadikan panduan kepada setiap pelajar untuk menjadi graduan yang holistik. Pada petang ini juga untuk makluman semua, semua fakulti dan kampus cawangan diwakili oleh pelajar serta pensyarah dan program ini juga dipancarkan secara live streaming kepada kampus-kampus UiTM di seluruh Malaysia. Sekali lagi, selamat datang diucapkan kepada semua, satu tepukan yang gemuruh kepada semua tetamu-tetamu kehormat dan juga penceramah kita pada petang ini. Bagi memeriahkan lagi program pada petang ini, majlis dengan segala hormatnya mempersilakan yang berbahagia Tan Sri Naib Chancellor untuk memperkenalkan CEO industri jemputan kita pada petang ini. Dengan segala hormatnya, dipersilakan yang berbahagia Tan Sri.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera dan UiTM sentiasa di hatiku. Yang berhormat Datuk Seri Idris Yusof, Menteri Pendidikan Kedua. Yang bahagia Tan Sri Datuk Seri Utama Arshad Ayub Ayanda, Pro Chancellor UiTM. Yang bahagia Datuk Seri Syed Zainal Abidin Syed Muhammad Tayyib, merangkap penceramah program bersama CEO industri pada petang yang mulia ini, ahli-ahli lembaga, universiti, ahli pengurusan kanan universiti, wakil-wakil kementerian, wakil-wakil IPT, AIM, dev-dev jemputan, barisan para pensyarah serta para pelajar yang dikasihi sekalian. Alhamdulillah, syukur kita hadrat ke Subhanahu Ta'ala, kerana dengan izinnya juga dapat kita berhimpun bersama dalam program CEO Industri dan IPT ataupun CEO Industri dan Universiti pada hari yang berbahagia ini. Ribuan terima kasih diucapkan kepada Yang Berhormat Datuk Seri Idris Yusof kerana sudi meluangkan masa bersama-sama warga UiTM dalam menjayakan program yang julung kalinya diadakan. Sesungguhnya kita amat bertuah kerana mempunyai seorang pemimpin seperti Datuk Seri Idris Yusof. Beliau amat sinonim dengan perjuangan bangsa Melayu. Inilah orangnya yang telah memungkinkan kebangkitan semula bangsa Melayu melalui Renaissance Melayu. Beliau juga yang telah membuahkan idea tabung pendidikan 1 bilion yang kini menjadi sebutan ramai. Perjuangan beliau merupakan perjuangan memartabatkan bangsa Melayu dan Bumiputera di persada dunia. Secara peribadi, saya amat teruja dengan kehadiran Datuk Seri Idris Yusof ke UiTM. Perjuangan beliau senada dengan perjuangan UiTM. Gagahnya UiTM dalam memartabatkan bangsa Melayu dan Bumiputera sentiasa mendapat sokongan padu beliau. Kehadiran beliau dalam majlis ini merupakan salah satu daripada bukti komitmen beliau terhadap perjuangan UiTM. Roh Melayu dan Bumiputera dan kecintaan beliau kepada kejayaan anak-anak bangsa jelas nyata. UiTM amat berbangga mempunyai seorang pemimpin negara yang amat mesra dengan UiTM ini. Berbanyak terima kasih saya ucapkan kepada Datuk Seri Idris Yusof. Program CEO Industri dan Universiti yang julung kali diadakan merupakan hasil buah fikiran Datuk Seri Idris Yusof yang menginginkan kolaborasi universiti dan industri bersifat praktikal, realistik dan mantap. Sangat membanggakan warga UiTM apabila kami merupakan institusi pertama yang menjayakan pengisian program CEO industri dan universiti ini. Paling membanggakan bagi saya adalah program ini melibatkan lebih 4,000 pelajar UiTM dari pelbagai fakulti yang berada di dalam Dewan Agung Tuanku Chancellor, dan sesi ceramah ini turut dipancarkan secara live telecast ke kampus UiTM di seluruh negara. Dan dianggarkan lebih dari 30,000 orang pelajar UiTM dan kaki tangan sedang menyaksikan majlis ini. Hadirin sekalian, penceramah kita Yang Bahagia Datuk Seri Syed Zainal Abidin Syed Muhammad Tahir, yang berkelulusan ijazah Sarjana Muda Sains Kejuruteraan dari University of Maryland, Amerika Syarikat, telah memulakan kerjayanya sebagai jurutera projek dengan Petrona Gas Sendirian Berhad pada tahun 1987 sebelum menyertai Petroleum Nasional Berhad, Highcom Holding Berhad dan Perdua. Pelantikan Datuk Seri sebagai pengarah urusan kumpulan Proton Holdings Berhad telah menjadikan beliau antara CEO Bumi Putra yang paling berpengaruh dan disegani ramai. Kejayaan dan sumbangan beliau dalam bidang yang diceburi ini telah mendapat pengiktirafan bukan sahaja dalam negara, malah peringkat antarabangsa. Kualiti pengurusan dan kepimpinan menobatkan beliau dengan pelbagai anugerah, termasuklah Automotive Man of the Year 2008, International Business Leader in the Automotive Sector oleh Middle East Business Leadership Summit Awards di Dubai, kerana berjaya menjadikan Proton sebuah jenama serantau dan global yang termuka dan semakin meningkat di Timur Tengah. Beliau turut terima anugerah Masterclass Bumi Putra CEO of the Year dan Global Leadership Award in Automotive Sector. Kecekapan pengurusan yang disokong dengan kualiti kepimpinan yang ada pada Datuk Seri telah memberi pengiktirafan kepada beliau dengan anugerah Brand Loreal Brand Icon Leadership Award 2011 dan Undeserved Man of the Year Award. Di samping mendapat Outstanding American Alumnus Award oleh American Universities Alumni Malaysia pada tahun 2012. Beliau yang kini memegang jawatan sebagai pengurusi eksekutif dalam syarikat seperti CMS Consortium Sendirian Berhad, Duta Klasik Sendirian Berhad, Brainy Bunch Islamic Montessori, Misiam Sendirian Berhad dan Difference Research Technology Sendirian Berhad, turut memegang jawatan sebagai pengarah eksekutif di Bio Alpha Holding Berhad dan Vidu Sendirian Berhad. Kepada seluruh warga UiTM yang berada di dalam dewan ini serta yang sedang mengikuti secara live telecast, saya berharap agar perkongsian dan pendedahan berharga daripada program CEO, industri dan universiti ini dapat menyuntik semangat ke arah memekukuh kematangan mentaliti, menambah nilai dan memperkasa keupayaan diri sebagai graduan UiTM yang memenuhi kehendak majikan. Sekian, wabillahi taufik wadaya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Majlis merakamkan jutaan terima kasih kepada Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Naib Chancellor yang telah memperkenalkan CEO Industri Jemputan sebentar tadi. Tetamu-tetamu kehormat, hadirin hadirat sekalian, kini tiba masa yang dinanti-nantikan oleh semua yang hadir pada petang ini, iaitu ceramah CEO Industri bersama University. Majlis dengan segala hormatnya mempersilakan Yang Berbahagia Datuk Seri Syed Zainal Abidin Syed Muhammad Tahir, Managing Director of Widu Sdn Bhd, untuk menyampaikan ceramah beliau. Dipersilakan Yang Berbahagia Datuk Seri.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahirrabbilalamin. Wassalatu wassalamu syafil anbiya wal mursalin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Rabbi syrahli sadri wa yassirli amri wa hlul uqdatan min lisani afqahu qawli wa la hawla wa la quwata illa billahil alil azim. Sedari pengacara majlis yang saya muliakan, Yang Berhormat Datuk Seri DJ Yusof, Menteri Pendidikan II, Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Datuk Seri Utama Dr. Asyik Ayub, Pro Chancellor UiTM, sahabat saya Yang Berbahagia Tan Sri Datuk Seri Profesor Dr. Sahu Hamid Ibn Abu Bakar selaku Naib Chancellor UiTM, para pensyarah, datuk-datuk, Tadi Tan Sri yang saya hormati sekalian dan mahasiswa yang saya hormati sekalian. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala wabarakatuh. Terlebih dahulu mari kita menyatakan syukuran kepada Allah Subhanahu taala kerana pada malam, pada petang yang mulia ini kita berpeluang untuk salah satu sesi yang agak murni, iaitu sesi CEO Industri dan IPT. Dan saya harus mengucapkan ribuan terima kasih kepada Datuk Sri Idris Yusof yang telah sudi melantik saya sebagai salah satu CEO industri yang telah diberi amanah untuk menghabiskan 30 jam satu tahun. Maknanya setiap satu bulan kami harus memberi ceramah 2 jam setengah. This is what we call giving back to the country and the society. Dan alhamdulillah apabila Datuk Sri tanya saya sebulan dengan lalu yang lepas, kata Syed, which university you want to pick? My first reaction was saya ambil UiTM sebagai tapak yang pertama. Jadi pada pagi ini, pada hari yang saya hormati sekalian, saya ini nak clarify sikit lah. Kita nak kata tadi all the awards that I've gotten, saya ini bukanlah pakar. Tujuan saya adalah untuk berkongsi. Dan dua minggu saya tengah berfikir, Datuk Seri, apa message yang saya nak sampaikan pada hari ini. Dan saya kalau lihatlah kebanyakan yang ada dawan ini adalah mahasiswa. Dan saya teringat, dan mungkin the best way to address, kalau saya melihat anak saya sendiri yang umur sekarang 23 tahun dan beliau masih belajar di universiti. Dan whatever you are going through, apa yang para hadirin telah berfikir dalam hati, dalam suasana sama ada tahun akhir dan ataupun tahun yang ketiga, I can imagine itu saja itu yang dialami oleh anak saya. Dan kami sering berinteraksi, sungguh pun dia berjauh, we almost Skype and FaceTime every day dan berkongsi pengalaman. Dan sebagai seorang anak muda, sudah tentu sebagai seorang ayah, saya sering memberi peringatan. Dan pada hari ini, Datuk Seri dan para hadirin, saya ingin berkongsi dalam aspek satu cerita. What I want to share you today is my own personal journey. And whatever you're going to see today, apa yang saya akan tengok pada hari ini, tak pernah saya berkongsi dengan sesiapa pun semenjak saya menjadi masuk dalam kerja. So there are funny pictures that you might see, dan you have to excuse, ini zaman-zaman jahilah, zaman muda dulu. Tapi apa yang saya nak tekankan pada para hadirin, khusus adik-adik yang anak-anak muda, selalunya kalau you might see CEOs or public listed company, dalam segi your perception, these are CEOs that born in a silver platter. Bukan semua CEO mendapat kebaikan sedemikian. Saya sebagai contoh, saya ni orang asal dari Kota Baru, orang kampung. Dan kalau saya sebagai contoh boleh melalui berapa liku dan proses dan menjadi CEO yang, you know, yang berjaya insyaAllah, saya rasa adik-adik pun mungkin, kita harap kalau ada impian, ada harapan, kemungkinan dengan apa yang saya akan berkongsi dalam satu jam setengah ini, mungkin akan beri sedikit manfaat kepada adik, dan apa yang baik boleh diterima, apa yang tak buat tak baik itu kita buang saja. Dan saya ingin membuat satu cerita daripada saya kecil, sebab kalau kita nak menjadi orang yang berjaya, kita bukan harus lihat di medan universiti saja. My upbringing that make me successful today is not because of my school in the US. Saya masih ingat daripada kecil lagi, apabila saya masuk ke sekolah rendah di Kota Baru, itulah pengalaman yang saya yang pertama, dan saya masih ingat banyak pelajaran yang saya dapat pelajari pada dulu sampai hari ini yang menjadikan saya bagaimana saya yang sediada. Dan saya akan berkongsi sedikit banyak. Dan topik saya pada hari ini adalah if I can make it, so can you. This is my journal of sharing to you. Nampak muka macam saya tak? Actually that video my son make me as part of my birthday present. Okay, pada hari ini saya cuma sekalian. Saya nak sedikit latar belakang. This working? Saya ni asal orang daripada Kota Baru. Adik-beradik ada 5 orang. Ayah saya adalah seorang pegawai kerajaan. Dia bermula sebagai seorang clerk saja. It was a clerk. A small clerk in Kota Baru masa itu di JPJ. Dan kami duduk di sebuah rumah kayu di Kota Baru, di Kubang Pasu. 3 keluarga duduk dalam satu rumah. Saya masih ingat. Ada TV hitam putih, 1 basikal dikongsi dengan 4 orang. So dari kecil lagi kami didik untuk orang kata cara berkongsi. Dan saya alhamdulillah dah berkahwin, dan ini 3 orang anak lelaki saya, ini bukan sekarang lah, ini yang lama. And they all have grown up and the others also married. Dan as a corporate, you know my history. Tak ramai orang tahu history. Masa saya, my first job adalah juru jual, salesman furniture. Di Kuala Lumpur, di Ampang, masa tahun 1986, di mana zaman itu is called economic crisis. There's a financial downturn. Saya balik daripada kerja, saya tak ada kerja dengan Petronas. Saya kerja jual Italian furniture. Dan saya akan berkongsi nanti. Now, I just want to start pada awal permulaan, my early childhood. Saya dilahirkan di Kota Baru, di sekolah. Ini gambar saya masa saya muda. Tahu mana satu saya? Tahu kan? As my mother, my sister and me. Saya bersekolah di sekolah menengah Padang, di sekolah rendah Padang Garung. Dan saya masih ingat masa di Kota Baru, tak ada bas, tak ada kereta. Kadang-kadang jalan kaki, kadang-kadang naik beca saja. Dan itulah permulaan, orang kata, memupuk semangat yang tinggi. And as I said, my father was only a clerk. Dia tak mampu ada kereta. Kadang-kadang naik basikal, dia kayu. Kalau tidak, dia naik beca. Dan apabila saya dah habis belajar di Kota Baru, belajar 1 dan belajar 2, saya terpaksa mengikut, berhijrah. Berhijrah ke Johor Bahru sebab my father got transferred to Johor Bahru. Cuba bayangkanlah, orang tak pernah keluar negeri Kelantan, kena berhijrah ke Kota Baru, ke Johor Bahru. Dan saya di Johor Bahru, telah new sekolah yang baru, belajar 3, belajar 4 dan 5, dapat kawan yang baru dan jiran yang baru. Dalam segi mental preparation saya, saya dah melalui bermacam. Ini dalam umur yang hampir baru 8 tahun. So I have to adapt in new environment. And inilah Kota Baru dengan bandar Johor Bahru itu agak besar. Dan tambah-tambah dekat dengan Singapura. Tak sampai 3 tahun, dah nak settle down, kena berpindah lagi. Dan semasa itu, ayah saya dipanggil untuk pindah ke Pulau Pinang. Dan pada umur 12 tahun, dah jahanam. So you can see my early childhood, asyik berpindah. And I cannot call one place to be called home. Dan sebab itu, kalau kita lihat, what have I learned over this brief early childhood? Pertamanya, I learned to be resilient. Saya daripada awal, and I was there, saya lah anak lelaki seorang. Tak ada kawan-kawan, tak ada abang-abang yang saya boleh berkongsi. So I had to survive on my own. Kawan baru, sekolah baru, cikgu baru, dengan environment baru, I learned to go to this hardship. Kecekalan yang ada pada diri saya dibentuk daripada masih muda. Apart from that, I learned how to adapt. Orang Kelantan cakap bahasa Kelantan, pergi Johor, okay lah. Pergi ke Penang, kena cakap bahasa Penang. You are what we call a new kid on the block. And I have to learn and to adapt very quickly. My parents were not there to guide me. Because they were, you know, my father was very busy. I got my sisters. Dan kita tak ada abah. So, these are the critical lesson. Dan kalau ingat balik, barulah saya faham. Dan ada hikmah di sebalik perhijrahan yang ayah saya buat. untuk membentuk saya sebenarnya yang saya dirinya. Kalau saya duduk satu tempat daripada kecil sampai asal, mungkin saya tidak mungkin ada exposure yang saya ada. Itu the lessons from the early childhood. Now, from then, I went go to my teenage years. Saya belajar di Pulau Pinang, and I went to Penang Free School pada Form 1 sampai tingkatan 5. And Penang Free School is a top school, masa itulah in Penang. And to get into Penang Free School, you must have good results in Standard 6. And Alhamdulillah, saya dipilih nak masuk ke sekolah Penang Free School. Dan in Penang Free School ni pula, predominantly a Chinese students. Tak ramai penutup Melayu. Dan kalau penutup Melayu ada tu kelas-kelas di belakang. Kalau pergi Science 1 macam saya, ada 4-5 orang je orang Melayu. Semua orang Cina. And from then, I learn how the Chinese behave. And until today, some of them are still my best friends. They are very successful. But that's how we learn how to integrate. Kalau konsep satu Malaysia ni, daripada dulu pun kita dah bersama-sama dengan rakan-rakan orang yang bukan beragama Islam. Dan masa saya masih ingat, saya di hostel di Penang. Masa tu saya duduk di rumah. Pada tahun akhir, Form 5, kita nak ambil exam SPM. Masa tu bukan SPMC. Ayah saya kata, okay Syed, I want to send you to hostel. Saya duduk di hostel. Tak pernah berenggang daripada mak ayah, tengok-tengok, dicampak di hostel. Sebab my father said, I want you to focus to be successful in MC. Saya duduk di hostel. Yalah, tidak ada TV, tidak ada kenangan. Tak boleh keluar, hujung minggu pun tak keluar. Sebulan sekali baru boleh tengok mak dan ayah. And that builds my character. Yalah, masuk hostel pun, mungkin kita pun kena bully. Sebab kita orang baru. Dan masa itu, saya memang aktif. I was very active in extracurricular activities, sokan, sea scouts. Dan saya kadang-kadang tengok anak-anak saya sekarang ni pun, they're not very active anymore. They will like to be in front of the computer, iPad, TV. That's for them is activity. Ini satu benda kalau adik-adik berada di universiti, di mana saja pun, jangan terlampau pursue of knowledge. Bagus. But the extra curriculum becomes very important. And saya yakin, if I have not involved in those kind of activities, I would not be where I am today. Now, I was active in sport. Saya main bola, saya main hoki, and I was, orang tak ramai tahu tu Sri, I was the Penang champion 410 meter hurdles and athlete. Orang tak tahu mana tinggi. Masa tu slim lagi lah, sekarang ni dah tak boleh. But I was a runner. And that also taught me to be disciplined. Orang kata si scout ni, orang si scout dulu, kalau orang masa Penang kata si scout yang suka curi ayam. Kita bukan curi ayam, but I went camping. I had to swim. Saya berenang daripada Penang sampai ke Batu. As part of our survival to get what we call a King Scout punya badge. Itu the exposure yang kita buat. Kalau anak-anak saya zaman sekarang ni nak pergi camping, oh takut. Geli. Yeah? Ini the reality sekarang. Dan kalau kita fikir, why the older generation are more resilient and more durable? Because we have a different upbringing. And I was a prefect in school. Teka mana satu saya, wallahualam, tak tahu. Orang kata muka nerd dulu. And when I look back, and this is a very important part of your life, daripada form 1 sampai form 5, there are few things that I've learned. Pertamanya, I've learned to be independent. Again, I was the only boy in the family. And the only friends that I have are my friends, and my sisters are all, you know, busy, and my mom, and trying to take care of the rest of the four sisters, and I had to be very independent. Kesemuanya saya kena buat sendiri. And that really builds, you know, the character of me. Keduanya, I have to learn from others. And until today, I still remember that by the form 4, form 5, when I was 5, science 1, I look at how the Chinese study. Enjoy. They play a lot of games. Tapi when they study, they really study. And dia orang tak kedekut. And until today, the same group of circle are my best friends until today. Yesterday, we just had an annual, you know, a get-together dinner. And they flew in from Singapore and from London. And we had, and these are, orang kata, satu attribute yang kita ada. Kita jangan takut dan segan-segan. Segan-segan orang kata bodoh sombong. Tak nak belajar daripada orang lain. Aku semua yang baik. I know everything. But the reality is not. Tambah-tambah belajar daripada UiTM ni, we have to learn. Bukan saja learn daripada rakan-rakan. Learn ni bukan kita copy. But we have to be prepared to open our mind and learn from the best practice of others. Kalau orang Cina atau orang bahasa Cina boleh buat benda yang lebih baik, kita ikut. Tapi jangan ikut yang buruk. That's something that we have to learn. The other thing that I've learned when I was in school was my character building. As a prefect, we had to learn about responsibility and leadership. As a Sea Scout, I have to learn about responsibility. Pergi, berkemah, how to survive, masak nasi dalam buluh, and all these things about, you know, building the character of being independent. So now I can survive. Mana-mana saya pergi pun, kalau anak saya yang sulung sekarang ni, kalau dia letak, mungkin dia tak boleh survive. And this is where today, sometimes our education system must be complete. Jangan terlampau fokus sangat on academic, dan kita lupa about the extracurricular activities, that's important. And I came from a system, masa saya belajar di US, and the emphasis is not only on academic. And lastly, of course, I learned how to take responsibility. Ramai anak-anak muda ni yang tidak mahu mengambil tanggungjawab. They want to have fun, tapi bila nanggut tanggungjawab, takut. They're afraid to take responsibility. And in life, sama ada you nak jadi kerjaya apa pun, even as a father, as a husband, you must be prepared to take responsibility. You cannot run away. Di mana-mana kita pergi pun, kita tidak boleh lari daripada mengambil tanggungjawab. Dan ini adalah amanah yang kita harus pegang. Dan kalau saya ingat kembali, the 5 years that I was in Penang School, it has taught me many valuable lessons. And why is it important? Because it is preparing my journey to the next step, which is my university life. Saya tahun 79 tak pernah pergi ke luar negara. When I was given, Alhamdulillah, I was given a scholarship by Petronas after the interview. In 1980, hari dia beritahu, then I have to go and study in University of Maryland in College Park. Daripada masa itu, it's a very big campus, 40,000 students. There's only 3 students from Malaysia yang ada, and they all PhD. And kita adalah the 6 undergraduate yang pertama and pergi to University of Maryland. Then in that journey, saya lah. Orang Kelantan keluar, nak jadi cowboy. The first thing I got was a cowboy hat. Ini gambar-gambar betul, eh? Bukan gambar-gambar. And I travel for the first time I travel overseas. Nak kata pandai cakap orang putih tu, taklah bawa pandai. Tapi saya beranikan diri. And I was there, it's only 6 of us. We arrived on one late winter and tak ada orang menolong. We had to survive on our own, cari accommodation sendiri, cari tempat tinggal, cari campus. Tak adalah ada Malaysian student officer yang ada. And I can still remember the day, dalam hati kita kata, kenapalah kita dibuang. Ada lempar kepada University of Maryland dengan tanpa-tanpa apa tuan. But not realizing then, that was a very good experience for all of us. Yeah? Then saya mengambil kesempatan, I stayed with the foreigners. Saya ada pilihan, I still remember. Masa tu ada 6 orang, masing-masing minta, jomlah. Kita ni tak ada orang lain, let's stay together. Nak sewa satu apartment, duduk sama Melayu. Then saya masih ingat, I still remember my father said at the airport. Dia kata, Zainal, when you go to US, I don't want you just to get an academic. You must get a degree, yes. Tapi saya nak kamu belajar. Apa yang kita boleh belajar daripada orang Amerika, orang putih. I still remember until today. And when I arrive in the US, I still remember, masa nak mencari rumah ni, saya kata, no, sorry, rakan-rakan, saya tak nak. I'm not going to stay with you. I want to stay with an American. Mula-mula dia pandang saya, you ni sombong macam. Kata tak ada. I said, my father pesan, when I go, I want to live among the foreigners. So I pergi. And I stay in one house, satu rumah besar, 9 orang, 6 lelaki, 3 perempuan. And I got one room dekat basement. Dan dalam rumah tu ada orang Iran, ada orang Kristian, ada orang Israel, dan ada orang yang tidak ada agama, atheist. And I've stayed in that house for 2.5 years. Dan dalam 2 tahun yang saya duduk dalam tu, banyak sangat benda yang saya belajar. And inilah the good and the bad part lah. And of course, orang takut kita kena pergi di luar negara, kita kena, agama is agama, but knowledge is knowledge. Kita tidak menggadaikan agama, I still pray, still berpuasa, dia hegan bila kita berpuasa, tapi, but the journey that I went through, the experience saya mengalami, and that was one of the most important choice, a decision that I made when I was in the university. Selain daripada itu, of course, I was involved in activities. And saya pergi, and I still remember Cik Fauzia, the Petronas officer. He said, Petronas scholars, don't just go there and get degree. Be involved. Understand the culture. Learn new things, because when you come back, Petronas want you to be a more holistic engineer. Kita masih ingat. Then saya dengan rakan-rakan saya pergi. I was active. Active. And one of the activities saya buat ialah, I also learn selain daripada engineering. I'm sure dekat UITM ni ada elective lain. Saya masih ingat, Rizri, I took one class. Engineering ni kalau di US, kalau tuan-tuan pernah pergi, most of the engineering classes ni semua orang lelaki banyak. Ha? Saya ni orang kampung, orang Kelantan, baru nak pergi luar negeri. Yang tahu tengok pun orang kata TV hitam putih saja. So, I went to all the chemistry classes, physics, thermodynamics, semua lelaki banyak. So, when the time came for me to take elective, saya kata saya nak pergi kelas yang perempuan banyak. So, I enroll in one class, so psychology 101. Purely because saya nak duduk dalam lecture besar, nak tengok ramai perempuan. That's the truth. But after that, I realized that that particular class, psychology 101, the topic of the class is a study of abnormal human behavior. And untuk maklumat semua, that particular class, saya punya assignment satu je, Dr. Sri. There was no book. Adalah buku, tapi you're not going to be tested. The only assignment that you have to take 5 subjects. Kita kena pilih 5 orang, 3 lelaki, 2 perempuan. And the rest of the semester, you are supposed to follow this individual, ikut, tapi jangan beritahu. Follow where they go, pergi cafeteria, pergi kelas, tengok cara dia berjalan, cara dia bercakap, cara dia makan, dari jauh. And that's what I did, I followed. Then bila kita tengok, kita kena buat andaian kita sendiri. We have to make an assumption, orang ni makan macam ni, mungkin orang yang gelojo, orang yang tak sabar, orang yang pendiam. And out of the 5, I make a survey and I make my own deduction. Then the last part of the semester, saya pergi approach dengan 5 orang ni, saya perkenalkan diri, suruh dia jawab soalan, a plan, 50 question. Then saya kena buat pembandingan. The assignment is, how best can you predict human behavior compared to the reality, which is the what we call the structured question. And out of the 5, I got almost 4 right. Satu tu saya salah. I got completely wrong. And I still remember that one guy is a black guy. Pak Hitam. Yeah? Yang kalau kita lihat dia berjalan begini, cool. So saya sudah pandang dari jauh, saya ingat ni orangnya aggressive, extrovert, bla bla bla. Tapi bila kita bagi soalan tu, rupanya he's a very reserved person. Quiet and all that. Then saya terfikir balik, why is it that I perceive him to be differently? So that particular class, yang asalnya untuk saja duduk dengan ramai perempuan, it taught me a valuable lesson about how to understand human behavior. And until today, kalau tuan-tuan duduk dengan saya ni, saya selalu suka perhati orang. Cara pegang tangan, pegang pen macam mana, bercakap macam mana, mata memandang ke tidak. Because those things really tells me more about the person. So I've learned. I was not there only for journey. I took a golf class, I took a horseback riding class. Semua ni untuk memberi karakter yang lebih berbeza. Of course, ultimately, I want to be a good civil engineer. Of course, I'm not a 4-star. I can tell you, saya ni bukan, CGPA saya bukan 4.0. Enough to pass and not to be kicked out by Petronas. That's the reality of it. But on hindsight, I did not turn out to be so bad after all. But if I were to be 4-star, duduk langsung mungkin tak kira, mungkin saya jadi orang yang berbeza. Now, jam ke? Masa duduk dengan Mas Ali, badan kita kecil, Dato' Sri, kita kena angkat berat. Kalau tidak, you get bullied. So one of my favorite pastime is lifting weight. Bawah tu sensor sikit lah, tak tutup aurat tu. What did I do? Kita dulu beasiswa Petuna, duduk di Maryland, hampir dengan Washington DC. Masa tu lawan RM337, $337. At that point in time, tak cukup. My parents was not, you know, rich to give me money. So I had to work. Saya kerja jadi lorry driver. I drive trucks for the university to deliver. Winter pun dia, summer pun dia. What else do I do? I was a football referee. Dari referee bola, bergaduh dengan player. Asyik bayang kad merah saja. First time nak bagi kad merah pada Mak Saleh kan, rasa seronok. Nak bertumbuk dia, tak berani. I was a waiter in a cafeteria. And of course, I was a dishwasher. So all in all, apart from just going to university, I'm not sure lah adik-adik yang sini, yang UiTM, berapa banyak kita yang pernah bekerja? Yang pernah tahu the value of money. Asyik kita dapat beasiswa, mak ayah tak ada duit, calling, masuk ATM duit. I didn't go to that route. For me to even go for holiday, ini duit yang saya dapat. Nak beli kereta, ini duit yang saya dapat. So I had to balance, I had to juggle my time. And because of that, the lesson that I've learned when I was in the university, pertamanya, It's about making choices. And I'm sure adik-adik sekarang ni, sama ada you are here and when you are in your career, it's about making choices. You cannot run away about making choice. Membuat keputusan. And obviously to make a choice is always the hardest thing to do. Kalau you are lucky, you have your mentor to guide you how to make choices. But if not, you have to look at yourself. You have to ask yourself, what's right for me? And when I was in the U.S., I made many choices. The first choice was to live in America. Second choice was to get involved in many activities. But when I look back and to question the kind of choices, I believe the choices were made very wisely. And saya percaya, I would not be what I am today if not for the choices that we make. So that's the first lesson that I learned. The second lesson that I learned was about not afraid to try. Ramai yang saya tengok. Termasuk anak-anak saya sendiri kata, takutlah daddy, I'm afraid. Why is there for you to be afraid? This is the best time for you to make mistakes. Bila kedua tua bangka macam kita ni, you cannot afford to make mistakes anymore. But when you are a student, you are expected to make mistakes. Remember, success doesn't come easy. Success comes with failures. Tapi ramai anak-anak muda kita ni takut gagal, lepas tu depressed lah, tak boleh bangun. This is not the science of to being successful. Nak berjaya, kita kena berani. Tapi berani pun kena berani berkena tempat. So you must not be afraid to try. And this is about a journey. And wherever you are today, you are in UiTM, and whatever you are going forward in the future pun, you still have to make choices, and you must not be afraid to try. Dan ketiganya, it's about confidence. I will tell you, masa saya sekolah rendah, and I was in Form 4, Form 5, I'm not the way I am today, even though I was a prefect. Takut pentas pun, I still shiver. Even today, sometimes I get goosebumps. But over the years, I build my confidence. Particularly when I was in the university. So this is the time, adik-adik yang saya hormati sekalian, cuba kita sharpen our mental character sikit. And the only way to sharpen is to put yourself forward and volunteer yourself. It's not going to happen by just studying in the library, duduk, bertanya dan soalan dalam kelas. But and so, you must. And today, the holistic student that we want, the future leaders of the world of Malaysia, orang yang ada ability and have a confidence, communication skill and so on. And that's what's important. And saya banyak interview, Dato' Mazna, my ex-boss depan-depan ni, we have interviewed many students. Saya kadang-kadang kesian. I want to read you one real life interview that I made when I was in Proton. Ramai student, and normally ialah, bila dah habis-habis tu, you ask one question, penghujung. You say, what do you want to be, what do you see yourself in the company in 5 years? Kebanyakan yang melayu dulu ni, I want to, saya in 5 years, I will be a good engineer, I will be a good manager. There's one Chinese student, actually, daripada UNITA. I still remember, I was the interviewer, ada dua. Dia kata, where do you see yourself in Proton next 10 years? He didn't even pause. He said, Dato, I want to take your place in 10 years. I hire him right away. It's impossible for him to take my place in 10 years, but that's not the point. The point is he was so confident and he explained why he want to be in my shoes in 10 years. And I was very impressed. So it's not your academic qualification that is important to you when you go to an interview. Of course, how you dress, how you speak is very important, but the level of confidence. Orang tengok ni masuk pintu je, people say you must ooze with confidence. The confidence can be felt by everybody. Tapi malangnya, kadang-kadang lah saya tengok, adik-adik yang, pelajar-pelajar yang keluar, yang graduate, from my experience lah, bukan kesemuaan, bukan keseluruhannya, tapi ada-ada yang masih lack of confidence, which is, to me, sayang. For whatever your parents have given trust of you, whatever scholarship that you get, at least, when you go, rather than getting a school degree, you must have confidence. Now, I also learned the value of money. Tadi masa nanti cakap dengan Tan Sri Yashak Ayub. Today, maybe we spoil our children. Just like me, I spoil my children by giving them everything they want. They do not see the value of RM1. Kita dulu dapat pergi sekolah rendah, dapat 50 sen pun dah boleh beli teh tarik dengan beli mie. Sekarang ni 50 sen is nothing. So we don't see the value of money. And the generation going forward do not understand the dynamics of numbers. During my time, I had to survive. Nak beli baju, kena kerja. Then I really appreciate. And every Money to me is very important. Bukan kedekut. You have to distinguish yourself between kedekut bakhil dengan orang yang prudent in spending. I'm very prudent. And I still today tell my children, my wife, we have to be careful what we spend. Jangan membazir dan sebagainya. Tapi malamnya kadang-kadang lah, kita juga sebagai ayah, I mean, we are also responsible of spoiling our children, and kita harap people can learn the value of money. Now, itu semasa saya di university. Now, pursuit of knowledge. Okay. Now, I came back tahun 1885 akhir. I worked in US for 1 year. Betuna said, time to come back. Masa tu tahun 1885. When I came back, balik saja, masa tu ada kemelesetan ekonomi. Cubalah you bayangkan, kita dah elok-elok kerja kat US, balik, tak ada kerja. And my father masa tu masih bekerja sebagai pegawai kerajaan, and they were in Penang. Saya masuk duduk Kuala Lumpur seorang. Sedara mara pun adalah pakcik seorang. I stayed at his house. And to survive, I had to work as a salesman. My friend who owned a furniture store in Jalan Lampang, the shop, rumah masih ada tapi kedai dah tak ada. I had to work for a salesman. Gaji masa tu RM300. To survive, I had to sell. And baru tu, that lesson I learned to see, now I know how to sell people things that they don't need. Apa yang tak mereka tak perlu, saya boleh jual. Orang kata bukan kelintung, tapi ayat yang kita pakai ni power sikit. So what did I learn? I learned about sales and marketing. I have never took a marketing class. Kita ni engineer. We learn how to build structures. We learn how to calculate numbers. All of a sudden, I had to deal and I had to sell Italian furniture. Yang mahal pula tu. Bukannya murah-murah. Berpuluh ribu. Tapi Alhamdulillah di Kuala Lumpur, Jalan Ampang ni, ramai orang kaya. Kita pun pakai ayat power-power sikit, bolehlah dia beli sini, dapatlah orang kata cari makan, dapat commission. Kalau tidak, I wouldn't survive. And what else did I learn? Of course, I learned how to struggle. I stayed at my uncle's house. Kebetulan saya baik, dia bagilah. Tak payah bayar sewa, makan for free. Then there was no entertainment for me. Pergi, jual furniture, balik. Setahun, 2 bulan. Then Alhamdulillah, after that, Petronas called me back and say, okay, we have a job now for you. And 1987, my next career was staying working with Petronas. I joined Petronas in 1987 as a project engineer. Masa tu, Petronas Gas and Dam Berhad. Our job was building the pipeline. Kalau masih ingat, the Peninsula Gas Pipeline daripada Kertih, membina pipeline gas sampai ke negeri Singapura dan sampai ke Kelang. And I was involved in the team. Dan kita diberi peluang, I still remember when I was in Petronas. Petronas is a very good company. Kalau siapa ada peluang, that's one of the best companies that I've worked with so far lah. Dalam segi training and exposure. And I still remember, we were sent to Canada. I was in Canada for 6 months. Training dalam winter, duduk nak tengok how to do construction and maintenance of pipeline. Then in 1992, I got tired of being an engineer. There's another choice that I had to make. Saya dah rasa bosan nak jadi engineer ni. I wanted something different. In my life, at that point of time, and at that time I was about maybe 30, saya rasa kekosongan. I feel that engineering is no longer my passion. So I asked for a transfer. I asked to be transferred to what we call corporate planning and business development. Because I believe to be much, if I were have ambitions to be a manager, I need to know about economics, I need to know about business and so on. So saya minta. Bukan orang yang minta, saya. I created the opportunity because I had a vision and I had ambition. So, those are the things that you have to do. Pada adik-adik yang saya hormati sekalian, kita kena tetapkan apa kita punya tujuan in life. What is it that we want to be? Whether you want to be the best engineer, you have to be clear, crystal clear. The kind of engineer you want to be. You want to be a lawyer, you have to be very clear. And I, as a practice, I adopt what we call a 5-year plan. Every 5 years, saya akan duduk, saya akan lihat sasaran. This is, when I left Proton, I was 50. And I sat down, saya menganggur 3 bulan, I didn't have a job. Dengan tidak ada pekerjaan, I just move around, look around, took a break. Saya pergi umrah, then I decided. And I was clear at that point in time, which is about 3 years ago. At 55, I was very clear in terms of what and the person I want to be. And that image of me in 55, until today, is crystal clear. And a very focused person. Satu penting. You must be focused what you do. And when I was in Petronas, I wanted to do something different, and I stayed in Petronas until 1992. Selepas Petronas, of course, in during Petronas, what are the things that I've learned? Pertamanya, seek challenges. In life, you cannot be in your kata katak di bawah tempurung. You cannot be, you know, in your comfort zone. You have to go beyond your comfort zone, and it's good to try. And I was in Petronas. I volunteered to go to Vietnam, pergi Cambodia, pergi Myanmar, territories that people have not been before. Because to me, it's experience. Of course, benda tak ada benda yang senang. But when I look back, those are the valuable things that I've learned. And you have to seek challenges. Kerana kita ni, generasi barulah. Semua menunggu. Waiting for something to fall from the sky. Okay, orang bagi peluang. Orang bagi scholarship. Tak pernah kita berusaha sendiri. And this is something that's wrong. I can tell you, adik-adik yang sempat disekalian, the reality is, the world out there is very challenging. And I fear for my children. Anak saya pun saya takut. And my eldest son, nama dia Adam. Saya Adam. I don't care whether you get a 4 flat. Of course, you must get a degree. But I want you to survive. I want you to learn how to have your survival instinct. That's the message that I always tell them. And it's very important. Tambah-tambah adik kita ni, orang yang Melayu dengan, you know, dengan harapan daripada mak dan ayah, we need to survive. Kalau you fikir keluar daripada UiTM, guarantee dapat kerja, dapat promotion, yes, there might be some of you are lucky, but some of you might not be so lucky. Pengangguran is still very high sometimes. So you must learn, you must seek challenges. The second thing that I've learned when I was in Petronas, I have to create opportunity. Kita ni jangan terlupa, cuma harapkan kerajaan. Tunggu kerajaan bagi beasiswa, tunggu kerajaan buat ini, kunjung kerajaan buat ini. Cuba kita tengok diri kita sendiri, what have we done? Have we created the opportunity ourselves? I've looked at many young people who are very good. Usahawan yang create opportunity or business yang sendiri. And some of them survive. Ada yang gagal, but it's okay. If I look at the top, you know, wealthy people here in Malaysia, kalau tengoklah the list, you know, you've seen it in all the magazine, they have failed many times before, if you ask them. And I've spoken two of them. If you look at their journey, gagal tu perkara biasa. So apa kita ni yang zaman generasi baru ni yang takut sangat? Afraid to, seek, challenge, and then also afraid to create opportunity. The other thing that I learned when I was in Petronas about sacrifice, pengorbanan. I got married when I was 92. In 1992, umur 30 tahun. Saya bekerja di Segamat, my wife was working in KL. And I had to drive every weekend. But I had to sacrifice. And I only transferred back just before my first son was given birth. So, in life, sometimes you have to sacrifice. You have to sacrifice yourself, you have to sacrifice your time. Tapi kalau kita nak the best of breed, sekarang ni saya nak semua nak. I'm not willing to sacrifice anything. Mana ada? The journey in life for everybody is about making sacrifices. Sekarang pun, kita orang tua pun, we are making sacrifices for our children. As we grow older, we make more sacrifices in our life. So, these are the things that you must be able to comprehend dan kita kena harungi masa kita masih muda. Interpersonal skill. Petronas ni is a company that expose you. Saya nak berkongsi satu a real story. Saya dihantar ke Petronas di I was sent to Vietnam. Masa tu saya baru senior executive but I was leading a team to negotiate on a refinery project in masa tu di Hanoi. Tahun 1992. Hanoi is backward. 5-star hotel pun tak ada. Kita pergi duduk hotel 3-star, kalau nak mandi, kena ambil mineral water, mandi dengan air dalam botol. But air dia kotor. So we went to this session dengan Petro Vietnam. Orang dah tua. Kita ni umur 30 lebih, dia dah 60. Duduk, cakap bahasa orang putih, diterjemahkan dengan bahasa Vietnam, dengan orang Vietnam. Kita panggil satu penterjemah. We call for interpreter. Dia, kita bercakap, dia terjemah. Kita bercakap, dia berterjemah. Bila saya tengok yang Mamat orang Vietnam ni, dia buat tak tahu, senyap, tak ada reaksi. And we were all very puzzled. Why is it that our communication was not effective? So one day, we brought our own Petronas staff from Ho Chi Minh, who was a Vietnamese, who came to us. Then bila kita go to that presentation, kena-kena, rupa-rupanya, our interpreter ni bagi interpretation yang salah. Can you imagine, 2 or 3 meetings have gone, he didn't translate the real thing. So, I said, remember, masa tu, the SOP in Petronas says in Vietnam, I don't know whether the SOP is still there, before you go to any meeting with Petro Vietnam, you must have a session with your interpreter the night before. Interpreter kena faham dulu. So it's not your skill sometimes. It's the skill of interpreter becomes important. So the point I'm to make is the interpersonal skill is very important. Huh? Relationship dengan individual ni. Tak kira kita dengan orang Melayu ke, international in particular, you know, I mean, how to react. And not many people have this ability to, what we call, establish a good, you know, relationship and develop a very high level of interpersonal skill. So that's something that I've learned when I was in Petronas. Now, after Petronas, 10 tahun, I served my contract. Orang kata contract, Petronas bagi biasiswa, you have to serve for 10 years. And I've decided I wanted to have something different. I want to pursue my other dream. Saya ni suka benda-benda tangan. I like manufacturing. So I wanted to go to manufacturing. And that point of time, the only company that's, you know, that's big in Malaysia in manufacturing is Hicom. Then I went to Hicom in 1995. I quit. And masa tu, my last posting in Petronas was at the president office. And I was working for Tan Sri Hassan Marikan. But I left. I could have stayed and perhaps today, you know, be somebody in Petronas. But I took the choice. I want to have a different. I just don't want to be an owner, I guess. I want to have a manufacturing environment. So I joined. Daripada manager. And when I left, I was a CEO in a company in Pekan. Masa tu, I still remember, Datuk Maznah was one of my, you know, directors in the company. But, you know, I wanted a new challenge. Of course, kata bukan every 2 years kita nak berpindah. And when I left in 1999, I joined Produa. I was already a CEO, dengan ada drivernya, running company, but I make a sacrifice because, number one, I was in Pekan and my family was in KL. My second son was coming and I said, enough is enough. There's no way I'll be commuting hari tiap minggu, drive balik ke KL. So I sacrificed. I took a smaller position, just a senior general manager, which is okay. So in life, sometimes it's not just about going up, up, up all the time. Sometimes you have to take a step down. Because you have to be clear what you want to do. Kita ni terlampau, anything different tak nak. Title is very important. It's not the title. It's a satisfaction of the job and the people that you work with. So I took a job in Produa in 1999. I was only the senior GM. And of course, working all my way. And by 2005, I rose to be the deputy MD of the company. Dalam masa lebih kurang 6 tahun. And in Produa, I also learned many things. And Produa, as you know, today is a company that has partners with the Japanese. One of the things that I learned in Produa was about partnership. You cannot work alone, and in the context of where you are going to be kemudian, sama ada sekarang ni lah. University partnership dengan industry. Industry partnership dengan the public. And all this about partnership, because as a human being, kita tidak ada capacity untuk buat satu sendiri. We do not have the capacity to do these things ourselves. So, one thing that I've learned in Produa is, if you want to go better, sometimes you have to lose certain battle to win a bigger war. And it's all about partnership. And that's what make company prosper today. There are companies that can reinvent themselves, be on your own, but learning about partnership was very important when I was in Produa. Secondly, I learned about cultural tolerance. Masa itu saya dihantar ke Jepun. I stayed in Japan for 3 months on my own. Tak kerti cakap Jepun langsung. Hike, 4 jam hike. And Japanese are the most tolerant culture that I've seen. Baik dia, hormat dia luar biasa. And that is why I understand the vision of dulu, look East policy. You can learn many things from the Japanese. I used to remember Jepun ni, kalau I used to buat perbezaan lah. Kalau di Jepun ni, kalau you arrive in Narita Airport, in the rain, the big winter, snowing. Selalunya kalau kapal terbang masuk taksi dalam airport, there'll be one or two person duduk tengah-tengah, directing the what we call the aircraft. In Japan, even there was a heavy thunderstorm with heavy snow, that person will still be there. Orang lain tak nampak pun, dia masih buat begini. Without fail. Sama juga Shinkansen, laju Shinkansen, orang tak nampak pun. Cuba kalau kat Malaysia ada macam ni, apa agak berlaku? Orang pun tak nampak. Kan? But to them, it's a culture. And I've learned that culture when I was there 3 months on my own, how to tolerate and how to understand the complexity of diversity of culture, particularly when I was in Osaka masa tu, something that taught me really about how to adapt. And one of the things that I've learned when I was in Produa is, of course, it's about communication. Saya nak beri penekanan sikit. If I were to ask all of you today, what is the meaning of communication? Kebanyakan akan bertanya, Dato' Sri, communication is about bercakap. Just like I'm doing today, tadi Tansi Sao, this is communicating. We speak, we deliver, and we have seen to have communicated. I can tell you that's not my definition. What is communication today? If you still remember this word, seek first to understand before you be understood. So which means what? Communication is not about talking, it's also the art of listening. To be an effective communicator, to sharpen the skill of communication, orang yang sekarang ni buat best communication ni, bukan saja boleh bercakap depan TV, bercakap, pandai, peta bercakap, no. It's about listening. Kalau tak percaya, tanyalah isteri saya. Abang ni tak pandai mendengar. So over time, I've learned to listen. Which means now I am much more effective communicator to my wife. Itu pun kadang-kadang tak cukup. So communication is a skill that you must have. And I want to share with you one book that I read. This book I read in 1981 when I was in university. A book that was written by a Turkish person by the name of Khalil Gibran. Khalil Gibran says in his book, and I will read this verb twice. Saya akan baca dua kali. Khalil Gibran says, if you want to understand someone better, again, it's not about understanding. It's just that if you want to understand someone better, listen not to what he says, but listen to what he does not say. And I repeat, if you want to understand someone better, listen not to what he says, but listen to what he does not say. Faham? Tak payah. But I relate to reality in life today. All of us here yang duduk depan-depan ni semua dah berkahwin kan? Yang mana tak kahwin tu, dengar je lah. Me and my wife, example. Bila saya ambil akad nikah tahun 1992 tu, ada tak dia kata, abang, saya ni kan tak boleh bercakap pasal ni, tak boleh bercakap pasal ni, tak boleh bercakap pasal ni, tak boleh bercakap pasal ni. Ini semua tabu. I don't think my wife have ever told me, don't ever talk to me about this. But over time, because I want to understand my wife better, I'm beginning to listen more than what she's saying. I'm beginning to understand the thing that she doesn't like. And that's what Khalil Gibran means. Sometimes we are too engrossed in listening and communicating, tapi kita tak lengok di sebelakang dia. And that's the thing that I've learned when I was in university, about studying about abnormal human behavior. It's about understanding. So when I say communication, it's not just about talking, it's about the act of listening, the act of observing, and the act of talking. Barulah kita jadi a good communicator. So these are the things, adik-adik, ya. Jangan kita ingat, oh, I'm going to go to a communication class, I learn how to speak, I can do public speaking, I'm a good communicator. No. Ramai yang saya tengok juru-juru acara ni, and I've known a few, they are the best newscaster, but when you talk to them, alamak, kosongnya. They cannot communicate. So communication is not a measure of how you speak. It's about how you interact. One thing that I also learned when I was, those are what I've learned when I was in Perdua. Then Alhamdulillah, orang panggil National Service, I joined Proton in 2006 until 2012, hampir 6 tahun setengah. Now, if I were to look back today, daripada, I was in Petronas, I was assessment Petronas, I was DRB ICOM, I was in Perdua, and I was in Proton. There are many things that I would like to share with you. To summarize it all, things that you should have, whether you are a student, you are a lecturer, if you want to be successful in life, there are a few things that you have to do. Number one, top of my list is about knowledge. Knowledge is key. Ilmu. Kita orang yang beragama Islam disarankan mencari ilmu di sepanjang hayat. Di merata. Orang nak mencuri pun adik-adik kena ada ilmu. Yang tak ada ilmu tu yang masuk jail. Yang pandai ilmu mencuri ni, they are free today. So ilmu is key. And until today, you think, oh, Dato' Sri dah pandai. No, As I speak to all of you, I'm still harnessing knowledge. And that is why saya suka berinteraksi dengan university, and I serve on a few as a visiting professor, because I look at university as a gold mine of technology. And knowledge is key. If you want to be the best engineer. And I have three things that I like to also mention. Satu, knowledge about your core study. Belajarlah, engineering ke, accountant. There are two other things that you have to learn. And I've learned, kalau ada dua ni, you akan complete. Pertamanya, you must have knowledge about finance. Everything today you do in life is about dollars and cents. It translates into numbers. Bukan suruh jadi accountant, but you must have some basic knowledge about finance. Balance sheet ke, aliran tunai, cash in, cash out. Itu pertama. The second knowledge that you must have is about branding and marketing. Everything is about branding. Tadi you were talking dalam masa tadi about one other university compared to IETM. Kenapa kita tak menyerlah? Walhal, the other university is very, bukanlah hebat sangat, but jenama dia luar biasa. We used to do a comparison. Pokok buah mangga datang daripada kampung di Perak, satu dijual di Malaysia, satu diekspor ke Thailand, buat branding di Thailand, kalau keluar ni produk, siapa yang lebih mahal? The survey says, the product from Thailand has a better value. Pokok sama. Rasa sama. Why is people willing to pay more for this product from Thailand? It's all about branding. So, for whatever you do today, be what you want to be, but I suggest, saya sangat beri penekanan, carilah some knowledge about finance and cari juga knowledge about sales and marketing. Kedua. Seluar sikit. Second is about discipline. Ini tak biar cerita lah adik-adik. Kalau tak ada disiplin, macam nak berjaya? Orang suruh datang kuliah pukul 8, pukul 8.30 baru sampai. Saya ni, me as a person, tanyalah sesiapa yang kerja dengan saya, saya pantang pasal timing. Demi masa, walas. It has to be 2 o'clock, it has to be 2 o'clock sharp. My children knows. If you want to leave a function at 8 o'clock, 8 o'clock, I'll be in my car waiting already. Because masa is very important. You must have discipline. And to be successful, siapa yang nak hire orang yang malas? Siapa nak hire kalau kita buat temu janji dengan orang, datang lambat. Lama-kelamaan orang tak percaya. Kita jual barang, kita janji, tak ada, kita mungkin janji. All this about discipline. So discipline is very important trait that you want to be successful. Nombor tiga, it's about commitment. Everything to life, commitment. Oh Allah, orang kata saya ni orang bukan committed lah Tun Sri. Saya bohong, saya kata semuanya bohong. Siapa sini yang tak pernah bercinta kat tangan? Semua pernah bercinta kan? Macam saya dulu lah bercinta dengan isteri. Masa bercinta semua boleh. Everything is possible. Gunung pun berani kan? Lepas akad aku terima nikahnya kan habis. So, when you tell me that you're not committed, I say, it's all rubbish. It's all about choices. You only choose when to be committed and when not to be committed. Itu masalah dia. Every fitrah manusia ni memang ada commitment. Tapi kadang-kadang pilih masa, pilih tempat. But commitment is key. Number 4 is about goal setting. Ini penting. Kita talk about wawasan, vision. I still remember I went to a training, Stephen Covey, 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. Stephen Covey, habit number 2, begin with an end in mind. What is the end game? You as undergraduate, mahasiswa daripada UiTM, apa you punya end game? What is your goal? Saya nak jadi Prime Minister. Tak apa. When people say aim, aim big, jangan aim low. Saya nak jadi usahawan, usahawan macam mana? Jangan jadi saya nak jadi usahawan yang berjaya. Apa? Saya nak jadi usahawan yang berjaya, yang boleh sekian. As I said before, the picture of you, the goal, is not only clear, must be crystal clear. Jelas sebabnya apa? Kalau kita tidak ada goal setting, kita cepat hanyut. Macam tadi, saya daripada Subang Jaya, nak datang ke Shah Alam. My goal, kalau taruh wish, daripada Dewan Agong Tuan Agung Chancellor. Kalau saya tak ada goal, saya tak pergi Shah Alam, pergi Kelang. Hilang. And you get distracted very easily. And dalam hidup, in reality, in life, sometimes there are too many distractions. But only the goal will keep you focused. That's why goal setting becomes very important. And saya punya dulu, daripada dulu, when I start working, I have what we call this 5-year plan. And every 5 years, I will sit down and review my plan. What is it that I have achieved in life? Because I'm a very focused person. Tapi Alhamdulillah, Tuhan bagi rezeki, Tuhan mempermudahkan banyak, tapi it's all because you have a goal. Takkanlah kita nak berjalan, ikut suku cerita, tak apalah. Kau nak jadi apa? Tak kisahlah. Ini, panggil-panggil orang sekarang. Tak ada wangsa langsung. I mean, cuba kita fikir mak ayah kita yang memberi amanah kepada kita. Cuba kita fikir orang yang memberi beasiswa, yang memberi harapan kepada kita, bangsa kita. Takkan kita nak jadi orang Melayu yang tak ada wawasan? Aku nak jadi apa? Tak tahulah. I mean, at this point of time, whether you are first year ke, you must be already be creating, crystallizing what is it that you want to be. Tak kira lah. Number 5 is about making decision. Choices. Jangan suruh orang pula, tak apalah, aku ikut, aku buat turut. Orang nak pergi sini, aku pergi sini. Orang pergi sana, pergi sana. No, you have to decide. I can tell you whatever you want to know, but at the end of the day, you have to make that decision. Kita kena lihat di kita, apa yang baik untuk kita. Apa yang baik based on your capability, and you have to make that choice. Jangan takut, oh tak beranilah dan sebagainya. I mean, when you want to be a CEO of any company, tak kira company besar kecil, it's always, every day is about making decisions. And sometimes I can tell you, I always not the right decisions. But as a leader, you have to make decisions. Kita tak boleh lari. Yang keenam, it's about communication. Saya dah cakap tadi. Communication, saya ni adalah Tuhan bagi kelebihan sikit. And I always like people to learn how to communicate in a true way. If you want to be successful locally and globally, today, I can go up on stage, I can speak to anyone. I have no fear. Gabrah tu adalah, biasa. Tapi, I have confidence because I know I can communicate. I have communicated with the CEOs of the world, royalties, ministers, prime ministers. Tak ada masalah. Because I'm prepared. And because I have this ability to sit and I have to know. And I always prepare myself. My chairman, Tan Sri Nazmi tahulah. Before I jumpa dia, I dah prepare dah. Sebelum dia jauh, tanya saya dah semua ada jawapan. Because that's about communication. You anticipate. Jangan pergi baru, tak prepare. Ini, you know, this is the skill that you have to acquire. And all this will make you a better person. Next, it's about innovative. Sama tadi, orang kata, Latok, innovation ni untuk orang engineer saja. Orang HR tak boleh innovative. Saya kata sekali, semua bohong. Ini semua, that's tak ada asas. Back to zaman kita bercinta. Pernah tak 2-3 kali kita, we are caught in a spot dengan girlfriend kita, kita tersilap langkah ke, terlihat cakap. What do we do? We find akal kan? Orang kata, tipu sunat lah. Corner sini, corner sini. What do I call that? I call that innovation. Innovative lah tu. Because when you cook the spot, you innovate to come up from the spot. But cumanya, innovation is about creating value add to what you do to add value to the company that you're working. That's what the innovation want to be. So, memang manusia ada innovative dia. Tapi cuma apa yang kerajaan nak buat sekarang ni is to create that innovative culture. Harness the positive innovative thinking into creating productive output. Bukan buat kreatif nak produce negative output. That's what innovation is all about. So every one of you has some innovative attitude or culture inside yourself. Question is how do you harness it? And innovation is the norm. A good and the best company, sometimes the principles are the same, but because the better company is the one that innovate. That makes life, you know, people are different today. Now next is about responsibility. Ini mana kita ada di dunia ni, kita ada tanggungjawab. Mana ada orang yang duduk boleh pergi daripada sejak kecil sampailah di akhir hayat yang tidak mengambil tanggungjawab. You cannot run away, adik-adik yang saya mahu sekalian. So the only way to do it is to prepare yourself. The day will come, tak kira lah kalau you kata, I'm not going to be an entrepreneur, I'm not going to be a boss. Mesti ada tanggungjawab. Tak payah pergi jauh lah adik, kita akan berkahwin. Kita akan menjadi seorang ayah atau seorang ibu. Kita ada tanggungjawab and you cannot run away. So, do not run away to a problem. The best thing to do is to prepare to face the responsibility. And you have to prepare. And the only way to prepare, sekarang lah. zaman adik sekarang. That's why I keep telling myself, saya Adam, Hakim Narif, be responsible. Ambil tanggungjawab, tak apa. Even things that you don't know how to do, it's okay. And it's okay if you fail. It's so I would rather you fail today than when you fail when you have grown up. But how many of us think in that man? People ramai ni lah orang kata comfort zone, complacent. Aku tak nak because kalau aku ambil responsibility, takut menunjukkan kelemahan aku. Kalau aku ambil responsibility, orang tengok aku tak pandai bercakap. Eh, malunya aku. Duduk dan diam. Siapa yang rugi dia, adik? When I was growing up, I would take the challenge. I was the first person to volunteer. Tak tahu pun buat. Because I believe that experience is mine and it's mine to keep. If I don't take, someone will take it and someone will become a better person than me. So saya, I got no fear. Even today, orang suruh volunteer, I volunteer. Next is can someone press them? Leadership. Passion. Leadership is passion. I'm the kind of person that can only work effective bila saya ada passion in what I do. Sekarang ni, semenjak saya tinggalkan Pondok Ramai, orang datang, Dr. Sri minta tolong. My rule is very simple. I must look at the business. Kalau saya rasa passionate about what, baru saya akan tolong. Kalau takat nak cari duit, no, I'm not interested. Sebab it's the passion that will come out and translate this product of yours to be beautiful. Sebab you cakap dengan hati, bukan kata kelintong. You cakap pun orang tengok pun, weh, orang percaya. Sebab dia, cara dia bercakap berbeza. Sebab kalau kita jual benda yang kita pun tak percaya, the customer out there will tell you. We are able to tell you whether you are passionate or you have confidence about your work. Next is about, there's no shortcuts in life. Kalau orang kata, aku nak jadi CEO Intel, yelah, kalau kadang-kadang kalau company ayah sendiri, mungkinlah. But there's no shortcuts. I started from a lowly project engineer in Petronas. Never in my dream that I will be a CEO of Proton. Tak pernah terfikir pun. But now when I look back, barulah saya tahu, and all the steps that I've taken are preparing me to make, to give a bigger responsibility. And there's no shortcut. If I were to perhaps, you know, kata parachute jump terus jadi CEO, I probably would have not been able to manage a company. Of course, during those time, there were bitter lessons. Scar pun ada. Orang marah, orang maki, hamu. Itu kepada biasa. Nothing to be fearful. Saya ni yang kata dah lali sangat. And I was in Proton, I have to face the public. Nak makan pun tak boleh. Saya ingat saya boleh lari. Kat masjid pun, subuh pun orang komplain pasal kereta. Tak boleh lari. That's the reality. So, I accepted that. And I believe in life to be successful, I have no shortcut. And lastly, number 12, never give up. Ini yang kadang anak-anak muda ni cepat putus asa. Oh Allah, tak larat lah, gagal. Tiap malah. Never give up. Kita, the most important is gagal, bangun. Don't make the same mistake. Jatuh, bangun lagi. If you ask me, Dato', have you failed? Like, I have failed many times. Many times. Daripada sekolah sampai sekarang. It's not all been so sweet for me. But what I know, today I will not make the same mistake as I did in the past. You have to learn from your mistake. That's very important. Tapi masalahnya kita ni, orang kata biol. Kan? Degil, tak nak belajar. Buat benda yang sama. And we have never. I have many Malay friends. I have many Chinese friends. When I look, I can see. I can see the difference. I mean, some other is their, in their blood, ke, in the culture, is different. And that's why today, I think one of the lessons that I've learned is, you know, is living among them and taking the best of breed. Even though I'm a Kelantanese, saya ni kalau ikut-ikut darah ni, ada darah daripada Hadramaut, orang Yemen. And I went to Yemen with my father and my children. I went to see how, you know, the culture in Hadramaut. Dalam sisi banyak, I can see. Somehow or other, adunan ni mungkin memberi kebaikan. I mean, whoever you are, whatever background, and doesn't matter whatever religion you are. Now, those are my prime time. Today, I'm doing a different thing. I want to pursue my passion in life. Is today, I want to be an entrepreneur. One thing I realize, Dato' Sri dan rakan-rakan semua, I think Tuhan ni maha kaya. Dia membentuk manusia dengan apa-apa. Tuhan tidak akan beri benda yang kita tak mampu membuat. Well, I was in CEO, I almost gave up, I complained. Then I realized, now God have given me the position, the ability to harness the knowledge. Now, and saya masih ingat when saya pergi, when I left Proton in 2012, bulan Mei. I went CPM, I went Citun, saya minta maaf, I just want to quit lah. I made that decision. And I left without a job. 3 bulan saya menganggur. And I fikir, what is it I want to do in life? Huh? Masa tu I was going to be 50, and many people say, Datuk, go back to GLC, you know, make the company. I said, no, I want just one day break. And I still remember, I went to Mekah, and I normally do this when I was in bulan puasa. 10 hari terakhir, saya pergi Mekah. Then for those of you yang pernah pergi ke Mekah, orang kata tempat yang paling mustajab berdoa adalah depan Mu'tazam. And I still remember. In the year 2025, sampai in August, saya pergi. And normally when I go, saya disuruh oleh ustaz saya, kalau pergi Mekah ni minta benda yang besar. Normally kalau masyarakat berdoa, I pray for Exora to be successful, untuk jual kita yang banyak, sekian-sekian, minta. Itu perkara biasa. I mean, kita minta kan? Kita minta bukan untuk kita sendiri, untuk orang ramai, untuk pekerja kita. Itu kepada. Tapi this particular time, for whatever reason, I only ask for one. Satu benda yang saya minta. And until today, kalau saya fikir-fikir, kenapa pula peliknya, kenapa saya minta satu? Saya kata, Ya Allah, Ya Tuhanku, bagilah aku pekerjaan yang rapatkan aku denganmu. And that's all I ask. And I didn't have the job. When I came back, it was in late August, September, all these companies came to approach me to be part of it. Orang kata, Datuk ni banyaknya kan ni. I can tell you, I was not even involved in all these companies. They came to approach me, and I believe my role was to help these companies. So today, Alhamdulillah, I'm involved in a few companies, and I was very selective because I want to help people. And that is why today I spend a lot of time, and one of the ways about helping people is about giving back to the... I'm involved in UTM, UKM, and today I'm in UITM giving a talk. I'm a board trustee of Yasaranjas Dari Sofia. I'm a Nazir Masjid for 6 years. Because I believe my destiny in life today is not about me hogging the limelight. It's about working, satisfying my passion, and yet give back to the society. And that's what I want to do. And for whatever, you know, it makes me comfortable, I'm comfortable. I do not have to appear on TV anymore. But muka saya ni dah orang gam. Nampak muka saya, orang tengok Proton. Sampai hari ni. People still think that I'm doing Proton. But which is okay. But today, I want to give back to the people. And I believe the journey in life of every individual ada dia punya matlamat dia. And maybe that's what Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala buatkan saya sebagai seorang individu yang diberi keupayaan, diberi peluang untuk menjadi seorang CEO, dan sekarang mungkin diberi peluang untuk membagi balik kepada masyarakat. And that's what I do today. And I'm very happy. I have a wife who is very supportive. Now, you all might think academic is important, leadership is important. Yes, get a degree and equip yourself to be leadership. But I believe the icing on the cake is about being a holistic leadership. You have the intelligent IQ, bagus. You got the emotional EQ, cantik. But what's missing is the S, the spiritual part. And I, over time, I believe, you know, saya ni lah, dulu semua lah, orang muda kan, nakal, zaman jahilah. I mean, but over time I've learned. The spiritual part now becomes very important to me. And until today, it becomes my purpose. And I was talking to Professor tadi, I said, today, I want to do what we call corporate da'wah. Because it's about holistic. I mean, you can be a very good leader, but in the context of Islam, there are a few things that you have to do. Number one, to be a holistic leadership, you have to have the element of syukur. Kita ni biar ada syukur yang Alhamdulillah ni biar senang-senang dalam bibir kita. Ini, oh my God. Oh. Cuba kata, Alhamdulillah. Kita kena banyak, bukan dalam segi konteks agama. Malaysia sendiri, I've traveled many parts of the world. We are indeed a very lucky group of citizens. Banyak lagi orang yang masih tidak ada keperluan. Of course, kita ditimpa musibah, banjir, earthquake, but ini semua cabaran. So kita sentiasa bersyukur kepada Allah SWT. If you are a CEO, you must be bersyukur. Dan Allah yang menentangkan. I believe it's not because you pandai. It's all been planned. The other one is about being niat. Tiada amalan, dimulakan niat. What is your niat in life? Nawaitu kita apa? Aku nak jadi kaya. Aku nak jadi orang kaya yang membantu orang. Kan? Perbuatan yang sama, niat berbeza, tapi niat yang kedua, perbuatan yang kedua akan memberikan pahala. It's all about niat. I'm sure everybody here, I'm not questioning the niat of everyone, but your niat must be very noble. To me, that's very important. I mean, kita adalah nak kerja kuat, berpeluh, nak dapat duit gaji bulan. Cuba kita pasang niat betul, dah dapat gaji, berpeluh pun dapat, berkat pun dapat. Ini yang kita nak. Adil. We have to be fair and just. As a leader, kalau tidak tak adil, susah. Kan? Orang kata pilih kasih lah, promote orang ni, tak boleh. You have to be fair. You have to be objective. I thought, I used to say one of my, orang masjid, I used to believe that running Proton was very stressful. I mean, bukan stressful, very challenging. Jadi nazim masjid lagi susah. Tak ada KPI. Tak ada chairman, tak ada board directors, tak ada advisor, tak ada apa. Ada satu, direct. Everything that you do, kun fayakun, jadi terus. Dalam ada hijau, kan, audience kita, ada biru. Mana kita nak tu? So I had to play a very fair role. I'm not favor anybody. Kita rumah Allah, kita kena bagi ruang untuk orang berumah ibadah. Itu konsep. It was very challenging, but I have to be fair. So it sharpens the skill, but fairness is very arbitrary lah. Banyak orang kata adil, tapi kadang nama je adil, tapi yang betulnya tak adil. Ihsan. I think one of the things that Datuk Sri Lisa want to do is student yang ada ihsan. We have to have compassion in what we do. We just want to be robot. Tengok orang pun dengan cara yang berbeza. Tengok orang guru dengan ada, tertata tertib yang betul. Kalau tidak ni kita kata cold. A cold CEO. Tak langsung tak ada compassion. Dalam agama pun kita ada hari ihsan. Takwa. Sabar, but patient. Patient ni lah. I've never been tested to the limit lah. I must say when I was in Proton, there was a time, nak kata, tapi max. The stress was unbearable. Tapi Alhamdulillah, Tuhan bagi saya banyak sabar. Dan I survived. And I remember having many conversations with leaders of the country. I said, the only way I can survive is for me being close to religion. And that's the only way. If I have not been close, I would have failed miserably. And I would have been very stressful. Shura is being consultative. Jangan kita fikir ni, kita buat keputusan secara individu. Tidak mendapat pandangan. And don't even think that you are smart. As a CEO, a good CEO will say, you are only successful because the people below you. You're not successful because you are smart. It's the people around you that makes you smart. Tapi kalau kita fikir, oh, aku yang pandai, aku semua boleh, langsung tak ada dengar orang, langsung tak nak dapat pendapat pada orang, ini saya rasa benda yang baik, tak baik. And just like mahasiswa, before you make, consult, ask. That's what parents are for, that's what friends are for, that's what lecturers are for, that's what counselors are for. Because you are going to one area that is very important part of your life. Benda yang kita satu, kata situasi, yang pernah belum pernah kita alami. I remember I have asked many people, and every time I want to make a decision, I will ask. And the first person that I will ask, of course, my wife, your parents, and kita kenalah bagi orang Islam, kita semua istikharah. The process must be right. When the process is right, the outcome is going to be a good decision. Kalau the process is wrong, the outcome is most probably will be a bad decision. Sama juga dengan companies. That's why many companies today invest in process. Kalau tak ada proses, cara kita nampak keputusan tu mungkin silap. The process is the one that guides us. Sama juga dalam agama Islam. Proses dia. Dengan consultation dia, dengan semangat istikharah. Itu semua processes that you have to go. So, in any way you go, you need to consult. Janganlah kita buat keputusan dengan cara mendadak. Dan hormat. Ini kenalah. Sepandai-pandai kita pun, bila kita berjumpa dengan orang tua, orang tua si orang tua. Guru kita. Ustaz kita, kita hormat. Jangan kita masuk, oh, aku PhD, aku dah MIT, who cares? Jangan. That's not the way. Tak luak pun. What's the take? Kenapa kita kadang-kadang terlalu banyak ego? Tak nak hormat orang tua. Tak nak orang yang lebih pengalaman dari kita sebab kita fikir, sebab kita ada jawatan. And that's wrong. And many Malays, minta maaf lah, yang sampai terlalu besar ego dia, he cannot even fit himself. I don't don't understand. And alhamdulillah, saya selalu dipesan oleh ibu dan ayah saya masih hidup. They always say, no matter Zainal, no matter who you are, you must rendah diri. That is very important lah. Alhamdulillah, I still remember. And takat ini, okay lah. Kadang-kadang pun kita manusia biasa yang penuh dengan kelemahan, ego pun datang balik. And we have to suppress it down. Yeah. So, all this is about, again, to recap, it's about all the things that you've learned. And jangan fikir adik-adik sekarang ni nak belajar masa, cuba balik kita imbas balik. Whenever you were young, sekolah, sekolah menengah, sekolah rendah, just like the things that I've shared with you. And you think academic is good, leadership is good, it's not even complete. And as a Muslim, kita kena ada lagi, orang kata the spiritual part yang kita kena perlengkapkan. Kita kena jaga hubungan kita. Hablum minallah dengan hablum minannas. Hubungan kita dengan Allah, dengan manusia kita kena jaga. Baik dengan Allah saja, dengan manusia kita gagal pun tak boleh. Baik dengan manusia, dengan Allah pun gagal pun tak boleh. You have to have a balance. And this is all about living in tamah-tamah sekarang ni. Dengan all the issues that you read in the press, sometimes it's very scary. My son, I'm 16 tahun, Hakim. I think about 2.5 months ago, call me back, you know, dia baca dalam internet. I said, Daddy, what's wrong with Malaysians today? I said, Hakim, why are you saying so? I read this internet. What did you read? People are saying bad things about Chinese and Malays. Daddy, your friend, your best friend is Chinese. What's wrong? Anak kita? Kalau tidak tahu interpretasi about tolerance and all that, I mean, can you imagine what's going to happen? So, as we take this journey, para hadirin yang saya hormati sekalian, ialah perlengkapkan dengan apa, adik-adik diberi amanah, tanggungjawab besar dengan bapa ayah, jadi kita perlengkapkan diri dengan perkara yang baik. Ini, I mean, I'm just sharing my experience. And I can understand where you're coming from. Some of you come from a nice wealthy family kemungkinan, and some of you come from a very poor family. And I came from, I wouldn't say that saya datang daripada satu keluarga yang kaya, yang mewah. My father was poor, and I had to remember walk to school, pergi mengaji, jalan 2 kilometer, pergi sekolah 10 sen saja, basikal berkongsi. And we never can afford. But alhamdulillah, I think my father have taught me well. But if I were to apply the same thing that my father taught me today to teach my children, I would fail. Generasi muda berbeza. You are different, you are what the generation Y. Your challenges are different, but the principles are the same. Now, I would like to end my talk with two important messages that I want to give. You can be whatever you want to be. There are two individuals that I like to remind. Saya nak remind diri saya sendiri. Then I would like to remind all of you today, whether you are professor ke Tan Sri, there are two group of individuals that you must and you must never forget. And saya selalu dipesan. And I've seen people who are successful because they remember these two individuals. And I've seen people who are successful and drop down so easily because they forget these two individuals. The first individual is your parents. I'm lucky my father and my mother is still alive. Pada mereka yang masih ada mak dan ayah, you must never stop saying thank you to them. You must never stop calling them. And I call my mother every day without fail. Saya ni anak lelaki seorang. Kalau saya tak call mak saya sehari, hari yang kedua tak call, mesti dia mengajuk. Guarantee. Kalau call yang ketiga, mesti dia menangis. And I would not be where I am today if not for the doa of my father and mother. That I can guarantee. And these two individuals is very important to you. And siapa-siapa yang masih ada mak dan ayah, jagalah mak dan ayah yang betul. Sebab mereka ini yang akan membezakan antara kita yang berjaya ataupun tidak. The second group of people that you have to do is your family. Your wife, yang lelaki ini, isteri lah. Orang kata, every successful man, there is a successful lady. And my wife, alhamdulillah, she's been a pillar of strength to me, zaman lah sekarang. Alhamdulillah, she has been in to understand what I do, and she also share the values that I have. And today, I have missed, this is the picture of my son, who just got married in January, and I miss my children. I was so busy trying to build a career that I forgot in trying to be a father. Don't you think, jangan fikir CEO ni semua orang tak ada masalah, everything is perfect. It's not a picture perfect. Life is full of challenges and obstacles. And I'm a very typical guy. Masa kat Proton, saya kerja punya lah kuat, 24 hours, 7 days a week. And I've left the bringing up of my children to my wife. And I'm not very close to my son. So the first thing that I did when I left Proton, I was with my son for 1 month. Saya dengan dia saja. And that 1 month, I've learned much more about my son for the last 23 years that I brought him up. And today, I think that was the best decision that I made. So as you pursue your whatever career, you know, do not forget the people that bring you up and make you what today. Your parents and your family. Dan saya nak pesan ni sebab saya tengok ramai anak-anak muda yang leka. They believe they are what they are today because their own specialty, because their own capability. They do not believe about, you know, doa and, you know, pertolongan berdoa. And that is something that you shouldn't do. So para adik, Tan Sri dan Aniskan, itulah penghujung saya. I will give you one more slide when I would like to leave. But before I end, first of all, my KPI today ada beberapa. Pertamanya, I must complete the 30 hours lah. So hari ni Tan Sri 2 jam setengah, 2 jam saja. 2 jam saja. Allah bagilah sejam sikit. Kredit sikit. Number 2, I just want you to tell you that for whatever CEOs that might come and talk here, we are just human being and we are all built from the same mold. If we can be where we are today, so can you. Kalau adik-adik betul-betul ada inspirasi nak jadi seorang CEO yang berjaya, ikutlah apa yang perlu, ikut daripada guru, daripada pencerah. There's no shortcuts in life. I want to pass you that message. That, mereka kata, Malaysia boleh, memang ada kebetulan. Memang ada kebaikan dia. There is truth in what they say. But there are things that you have to do and there are pitfalls that you have to avoid. Ha? Jangan semua, wah, berjaya. Ada yang mungkin smooth sailing, tapi kadang-kadang kita kena turun. Jangan kita duduk di awangan-awangan sangat. Ha? We have to bring down. That's my second. My third message to you is, academic is not the most important thing. It is important. I think what we want to do is what we call the CCGPA, the cumulative. It's talking about holistic. It's about activity. It's about character building. It's about confidence. Huh? The leaders of Malaysia might one day, the Prime Minister of Malaysia might be from UiTM, might be in this hall here. What kind of a Prime Minister do we want to be? What kind of a leader of Malaysia want to be? Kalau kita nak jadi orang bangsa Melayu. You must have confidence. And this is the time. The arena, the platform that you must be willing to make mistakes. Jangan takut adik-adik. I have made many mistakes dulu masa kat saya study, kat Proton, I make many mistakes. Even sekarang. Tapi when you make mistakes, you must be brave enough to admit that you are wrong and move forward. My fourth message to you is, you be a good academician, be a good, tapi janganlah kita lupa, kita khusus. This is not only for Muslim, for people who have added the faith, kita yang beragama Islam, kita ada tanggungjawab. The spiritual part ni, kita kena bagi penekanan. At the end of the day, adik-adik, I will leave you with this one message. Only you can make the change. It's all about choices. Katakanlah apa, kita buat apa, seminar ke apa ke, tapi if you don't take charge of your own destiny, individually and collectively, nothing else will happen. I took charge by my own destiny. I decided what I want to be in life. And today, I want to make sure that that destiny can be fulfilled. Of course, destiny yang baik, pekerja yang mendatangkan kebaikan kepada masyarakat, kepada negara, kepada ibu dan lain-lain. Itu become very important. So, itu sajalah adik-adik yang saya mahu sekalian. Sekali lagi, saya minta ampun dan maaf sekiranya ada kekurangan. Saya datang ke sini sekadar bukanlah mata expert dalam, I didn't want to talk about cars, no, I want to talk about business. There will be other credits that I come here and talk about. Today, I want to share with you, to give you a dream. To say, if I want to be a CEO, like Datuk Seri Zainal ke, like Tan Sri Azman Mokhtar, Datuk Tan Sri Shahul, you can be that person. But a dream can only be filled if you take the next, the right steps. And today, as I mentioned to you, it's about the journey. So saya berdoa kepada Allah SWT supaya semua mahasiswa daripada UiTM yang ada, semuanya pensyarah-pensyarah yang ada, kita diberi kekuatan dan keimanan, keazaman, harapan bangsa dan negara Allah amat besar. And that is why I choose UiTM to be my first destiny of being lecturer, because I believe all of you are the future leaders of the world, of Malaysia. I mean, my time, Tan Sri, our time has passed. Kita ni dah aja ni dah, Tan Sri, Asyayu mungkin, saya dah 5 Sri ni kata dah, dah kesana dah sikit lah. Your time is prime. Janganlah kita menghabiskan masa dengan WhatsApp berlebihan, Twitter berlebihan, mentabungkan fitnah berlebihan, bercerita pasal orang berlebihan. Ini semua, para hadirin sekalian adik, semuanya tak mendatangkan faedah. Believe me, it will not do you any good. But it will do you good if you are focused on your work, you listen to people, you absorb, take what's good and leave what's bad. Dan mudah-mudahan pengurusan ini akan mendatangkan kebaikan. Dan saya sekali lagi ucapkan terima kasih kepada Datuk Seri Yusof kerana memilih saya sebagai CEO industri pada Tan Sri Sahur yang beri ruang. And I was told today ada tayangan Chaurasta pula tu. I went Penang, Chaurasta di pasar. And it's a story, I believe, I recall a story about person that has went through a hardship. And maybe that story that you see tonight can relate to all of you in, if you aspire to be successful. So thank you once again, and I hope, you know, to welcome a new Q&A. Wabillahi taufiq wa hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh.
Sekali lagi, hadirin hadirat sekalian, marilah kita bersama-sama memberikan satu lagi tepukan yang paling gemuruh kepada CEO kita pada petang ni yang berbahagia, Datuk Sri. Pihak majlis merakamkan jutaan terima kasih di atas kesudian yang berbahagia Datuk Sri untuk menyampaikan ceramah yang penuh bermakna bagi semua yang hadir pada petang ini. Lessons learned daripada Datuk Sri, kalau saya kira tadi ada 20. Tips to be successful ada 12. Dan juga holistic leadership ada 8 elemen. Itu yang saya kira kita boleh confirm. Ya. Baiklah, tetamu-tetamu kehormat, hadirin hadirat sekalian serta barisan pelajar UiTM yang dikasihi. Kini tibalah masa untuk sesi soal jawab. Kita benarkan hanya 2 soalan sahaja. Jadi siapa yang dulu, kita ada mic di sebelah kiri saya dan juga di sebelah kanan Dewan. Maka perkenalkan diri anda dan sila teruskan dengan soalan. Baik, kita ada, okey, sebelah sini, silakan.
Assalamualaikum, nama saya Nuriza Amira, Datuk Sri. Saya ada satu soalan. Ada juga keadaan di mana pelajar atau graduan boleh berkomunikasi dengan baik, mempunyai keyakinan diri yang tinggi dan sebagainya. Tetapi apabila menghadapi suasana pekerjaan yang sebenar, mereka tidak perform. Apa komen Datuk Sri? Okay, sekian, terima kasih.
Terima kasih atas soalan tadi. Satu lagi soalan ya, Datuk Sri. From that side, okay, sebelah kanan sana, kita beri peluang.
Datuk Sri, how do you know when to make a... Datuk Sri, how do you know when to make a...
Okay, perkenalkan diri dulu, pelajar yang disayangi.
Okay, my name is Audi. My question is, Datuk Sri, how do you know when to make a right decision?
Okay, when do I know to make the right decision? Okay. Okay, 2 soalan. Ini adik Nuliza. Soalan yang pertama, if I understand correctly, ada pelajar yang masa belajar, I mean, they are well-equipped, pandai dalam sebagai aspek, tapi when they go to the reality, mereka tak boleh menjalankan tugas. Memang ramai. And I've seen many anak-anak adik-adik yang masa dikerja dalam peloton pun datang dengan qualifikasi yang tinggi, honours dean's list, honours degree, extra collectivity. Tapi bila datang pekerjaan, dia rasa kaku. They freeze. Now, there are 2 things that saya boleh mungkin bagi pandangan lah. Of course, tidak ada individu yang sama. Masing-masing berbeza. Pertamanya, kita kena kaitkan apa yang kita belajar dalam universiti dengan reality di luar. Adik-adik semua ni sebenarnya bernasib baik. You are very lucky. Zaman saya dulu, bila saya study civil engineering, internet tak ada. Handphone pun tak ada. The only access to knowledge yang saya ada is to go to a library. Itu pun, it's all theory. And I still remember, the only resource that I have is my professor yang dia bekerja dengan civil engineering kami. So adik-adik yang ada sekarang ni, if you now have access to information at your fingertips, I urge you to use that power that people give you untuk menjadikan kebaikan. Kalau kita belajar, for example, legal, lawyer, commercial marketing. Kalau kita nak pergi interview, nak pergi bekerja ni, janganlah kita ambil pergi dengan tak prepare. Why don't you do your research? You Google apa, banyak benda yang kita boleh baca. To do what? To build the confidence and to become the bridge between the university and what the industry need. Kadang-kadang adik-adik, dia punya expectationnya berbeza. You are a sales marketing graduate. You fikir you are go to a sales marketing company, semua boleh buat. You masuk tangan kanan, oh, tengok-tengok the reality business. Dalam dunia yang di luar, it's all about reality, it's about people. So you cannot assume whatever theory that you study in university, you can do 100%. And the only way, I've seen people lah, that can bridge that gap, is they prepare themselves. And you are so lucky. Tanyalah, that's why I said, kita kena belajar pada orang. If you want to, if you fear that will happen to you, my advice to you is, pertamanya, buat kajian dulu. Saya nak pergi syarikat sebenarnya. Sekarang ni, every information about company is in the internet. Pertama. Keduanya, cari case study yang ada. Apa realitinya? Itu mungkin a reason why people cannot bridge. The second thing that I believe is about confidence. Maybe in your comfort zone, you are in your lecture, in your, you know, theater and all that, you feel confident because kemungkinan within your peers, you tak ada perbezaan. Everybody looks at the same. But the moment you go into environment, you are competitive. They tengok you are the only Melayu. There are Chinese, there are other nationalities yang bekerja lebih baik. Kita dah ada inferiority complex. Dah kita mula kecut. And what's the point? You can be the best, but the moment you go the reality, you shrieze. Kita beku dan sebagainya. And the only way to overcome, as I said just now, is about confidence. And confident bukan bagi orang bayar degree RM50, RM100 ke juta. I want to buy a degree in confidence. No. Mana ada? Tansi ada tak course? Diploma in confidence. Tak ada. Mana ada? Confidence is going to the school of hard knocks. You have to go to the mill. And to go to the mill is to be the one. To expose yourself. It's all about success. It's all about failing. Barulah you ada kekuatan. Jadi bila you melangkah kepada industri, membekalkan dengan informasi, teori, praktikal you ada, membekal dengan knowledge yang you ada dalam segi, you know, the research that you make, to get the confidence, baru ya you boleh adapt. And sometimes I notice, orang yang CGPA 2.8 yang atas pagar ni, they adapt better daripada 4.0 flat. I give you one classic example lah. Saya di University of Maryland. This is true story, Lusri. Nama dia Chong. A Chinese boy from Ipoh datang to University of Maryland belajar university. Electrical engineering. Orang ambil satu semester 4 classes. Dia ambil 8. 8 classes which is, Datuk Mazlan tahu lah, it is unthink of in University of Maryland. Ambil 8, straight A's. But the only thing that he does is study. And the only thing that he reads, I wouldn't want to think lah apa yang dia baca. Dia tak ada aktiviti lain. And when I met him the other day, he's just a normal engineer. He could not do that. The 3 years that he was US, he didn't even integrate. That was a choice that he made. So, Noliza tadi, to answer your question, there are people who cannot adapt. My only advice to all of you, to adik-adik yang semua di sekalian ni, selain daripada apa yang kita belajar, cuba kita cari pendekatan yang berbeza. Today we are given what we call in the digital age. Banyak benda yang terbaik. Itu yang pertama. Yang kedua, adik Auri tadi ya. When do I know when the decision is right? Wapu si tahu, I do not know. The reality, mana kita tahu? Mana kita tahu? Oh, ini jawapan yang apa ni keputusan yang baik. Saya bagi contoh. I give you a very classic example yang demonstrate that I do not know. But Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala lebih tahu. This is a true story. Amai orang tak tahu ni, I will tell you. I was going to quit Proton. I got two letters in my hand, satu kepada the chairman, satu pada Tun Mahathir. Berminggu saya memikir. Semayang istikharah, saya dah tak ada tanda ni. Macam mana ni? Is this the right move or not? I do not know. I mean, of course, masa tu kita dah, you know, takutlah. Tak pernah tak ada kerja. So I spoke to my wife, kata, macam mana ni? It's on Wednesday morning. Wednesday malam. I say, okay, kata, gini lah. Semayang istikharah dia sekali. So semayang malam tu, 11:30 saya masih ingat. 11:30 malam, sebelum tidur, saya semayang istikharah. 5:30, bangun subuh, saya kejut. Sam, tak ada tanda. Macam mana ni? Tak ada tanda. Now, I have to decide because if I delay my decision, it have a really big impact to the organisation. Tak ada tanda. Tak apa. Saya makan breakfast dengan dia. Kau 7:30 pagi duduk makan. And jangan-jangan saya makan breakfast, duduk. Buka TV. Buka TV, keluar program Datuk Fadilah Kamsah. And I don't listen to Datuk Fadilah Kamsah on TV lah. I know him personally. Saya tak dengar. Datuk Fadilah Kamsah keluar. Saya tengah minum. Minum, makan dengan dia. Tiba-tiba Datuk Fadilah Kamsah dengar suara dia. Dia berkata apa? Kalau kamu masih ada kesangsian dalam keputusan yang kamu nak buat, tapi sekiranya kamu telah bersemayang istikharah, sekiranya kamu telah berbincang dengan keluarga dan mak dan ayah, walaupun keputusan itu salah, Allah akan mempermudahkan. Subhanallah. Saya dengar tu, saya dengan isteri saya berhenti makan. Siapa yang bercakap tadi? And honestly, lepas tu Fadilah Kamsah change the subject to another topic. Saya berdiri belum lama. Seolah-olahnya itulah tanda yang saya menunggu pada Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. Immediately after that, I showered. I went to Tun's office, to Tan's office. This is my letter, isn't? The rest is history. To answer your question, you will never know. You just must have faith in whatever you do. And nothing is perfect in life. Nak tunggu benda yang ideal? Impossible. You want to find the right CEO? You will never get it. At least you can come close. The rest is about molding up. You want to make the right decision? The decision might not be there. Tapi kalau you go to the process, tadilah bahawa syura, bermuafakat, tanya, solat, istikharah, insyaAllah, bukan selalu, tapi even tu salah, Allah akan mempermudahkan. So I hope I answer your question. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi taala.
Tetamu-tetamu kehormat, hadirin hadirat sekalian, dengan jawapan kepada soalan yang terakhir sebentar tadi, maka berakhirlah program CEO Industri Bersama Universiti di Dewan Agung Teguh Chancellor petang ini.